So it's great to be at Redcliffe, and it's great to be at Redcliffe with Nina, right? So that's why we're wanting to do a little bit more, just like because of having three locations and different things, we kind of like spent a little bit of time concentrating on Warner because for a time Warner paid the price for having Redcliffe and having Morayfield. Right? A lot of our best musicians and leaders, go out to the different locations. And so we've just spent some time there. So we've been less, as we have been, in our locations, but we decided we're going to do it together. So instead of kind of normally what we would do is that Nina will go to Morayfield, I'll come here, or the other way around, we're just going to come together because you know what? We're better together, right? And I like it too. Because I like, even though Nina has to hear the same message all the time, right? She could probably preach this message today. So, Pastor Hendrico, do you like that? Pastor Hendrico has been doing the Blackie tour, right? So he's gone from here to Morayfield and then a Warner today. So we just love Hendrico. Hendrico is such a ball of energy in our staff meetings. He's got great one-liners. He keeps us all laughing. One of the healthy things that I look for in our staff is I think about our staff meetings and I look at how much laughter is in our staff meetings because I don't want it just to be droll and boring and kind of just whatever, right? I actually want it to actually be fun. And what we could possibly do in, three quarters of an hour sometimes takes us 2 to 3 hours because we're just laughing and telling stories and having a great time. And Hendrico is one of those, just makes us laugh. And so keep on loving him because he loves you very, very much. And I want to say that there is definitely something in the spirit here. There's something in the atmosphere that God is doing something. And I just sense it's like, Redcliffe, when it was first started, was like a beacon church. When you go back into like the early 60s, late 50s, when it was first started, it was like a beacon church. It was like the Pentecostal church putting its roots down and saying, we're here. We are going to do something. And I sense that it's always been meant to be a flagship church in this area. But I actually believe that is coming into a re-emergence, right? That there's a new day that's coming for Redcliffe. And that you here are actually part of that. And that God is actually going to go and do something. And I believe that you're going to have quite an accelerated growth spurt coming in the next little while. So get ready for that because when there's growth, it always comes a little bit uncomfortable. Right? It always like, oh, I used to see that, I used to happen, or that's now going to change, or different things happen, but be glad for that, because God is actually doing something, and I just sense that. I didn't prepare myself to say that. I'm just standing here today. So I'm going to pray. Father, I pray that as I speak this morning, that you would take the spirit of what I'm going to say and put it in the heart of the people, oh God. Father, I pray, help me to communicate your truth today, your word. And Father, because no one came here to hear me, they came to hear you. So I pray, speak to them through this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to start by watching just a 3-minute video. Thank you. Thank you. Whether you're a sinner or whether you're a saint, God will love you every step of the way. You know, recently I spoke at Warner, and I spoke about Paul's attitude towards the Thessalonian church that he had started and he was pastoring in, and how he put others before himself. He said, when I look after you, he goes, I became as a nursing mother. And there's literally no one on this planet who is more sacrificial than a nursing mother whose whole life is about the nursing of another human life. That's what a nursing mother does. And I spoke about the humility that we need to show as Christians, and that we need to actually be humble people, and that arrogance actually has no place in the life of a Christian. And I stress that even though we are Christians, we are not actually better than the people who have yet to come to church. We are not better than people who have not yet given their lives to Christ. We are not better than the people of the world. And so therefore we cannot act superior. But many times in our attitudes and in the way that we treat or even think about the world, we actually think that we're better. And we display that, and that's what they feel. That's what they receive, and that's why many have rejected the church, because they just see them as being judgmental and as having seen themselves as being better. So I think that we need to be careful not to act in such a way to feel superior to those who are not yet Christian. And that's when I remembered this song. This song is about God's love. Whether you're a sinner or whether you're a saint, God loves you. Now, it's confronting, because we like to categorize people. We like to say, this person, yes, they're definitely worthy of God's love, but I don't know about them. Look what they're doing. Are they really worthy of God's love? I'm not so sure. There's a line in that song that says, whether you're the abused or whether you're the abuser, God still loves you. It's very confronting. You know, I remember watching a movie with T.D. Jakes' first movie. It was called Woman, Thou Art Loosed. And it starts off with the scene in a church, and they're at an altar call, and these people have given their lives to Christ, and all you see is one girl get a gun out of her bag and shoot someone at the altar call. And then the whole story of that movie is about what led up to that. And what it was, she'd gone up to receive Christ, and she looked up, and she saw the man who had sexually abused her most of her life also giving her life to Christ, and how his life to Christ. And she just couldn't deal with that. And she had a gun, and it went on. So that was just, how do you love the abuser? I understand that we got to love the abused. I understand we got to have that, but loving the abuser, I'm not so sure. See, this shows us the difference between God's love and man's love. I remember watching a movie or an interview with Ted Bundy, his notorious serial killer who killed, you know, dozens of young women. And as I watched it, I just became increasingly uncomfortable. I kept thinking, how can this man go to heaven when maybe some of the girls that he killed and ended their lives is actually in hell now? How can that happen? And to be honest, it made no sense. And to be honest, to this day, I still don't understand it, and I still really can't come to terms with that. But it shows me how far I need to go to understand and fathom the love and the indescribable love and breadth of what Jesus did for us on the cross. Because I'm going to look at it in human terms, but it has much more than that. This song challenges me, because how can God love everyone? There are people who I think don't deserve God's love. People who have done horrible things to other people. Any looking at of history, it's horrible. There are people in this room right now who have had terrible and despicable things done to you. How do I look you in the eye and say God loves the person that does that to you or did that to you? Yet right down deep in my spirit, I know and it's true. God in his magnificence can and does love everyone. Now, the key is in forgiveness. God forgives. God forgives us. So we have to be okay that he's going to forgive others. We have levels. Well, this is a forgivable sin, but if you did that, no, I'm not sure you can be forgiven. We kind of go, God, but I don't know, I'm not going to forgive you for that. God doesn't have levels. Sin is sin is sin is sin for God. Because if God has levels, we're actually all in trouble. We may be back under the law, which would leave us hopeless. Because as the Bible tells us clearly, no one can be made right under the law. See, under the law, if you sin once, you're guilty. Under the law, if you sin 100 times, you're guilty. Under the law, if you sin big, you're guilty. Under the law, if you sin small, you're guilty. You're still guilty. And as Paul says in Romans, the law makes you guilty. If you didn't know something was wrong and you did it, you can't really be at guilt. But once you're told of it, then you know that you're guilty. So that's what the law does. It presents it and almost makes us guilty because now we know. By Moses, by proclaiming God's law, makes everyone guilty. We all now know. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. If God has levels, we're still living under the Ten Commandments, but now it's 100 commandments. Or it's 1,000 commandments. Now, I do want you to listen carefully. I am not saying that we no longer have to heed the Ten Commandments. There are still consequences. If you lie, you're going to have continuous relationship troubles. If you murder someone, you're going to go to jail rightfully, and I'm glad you are. Right? There's still consequences. God will forgive you, but there's still consequences. If you covet your neighbor's goods and get in a death scroll on Instagram all the time, don't be surprised that one day you end up in a measure of depression and dissatisfaction with where your life is at. If you disrespect the Sabbath and you work 7 days a week, don't be surprised if soon you're going to be in some lack or sickness or in breakdown. See, the Ten Commandments are for us. They're not for God. Though through Jesus, you'll be forgiven and accepted into heaven, your sin will surely be covered and you'll actually face no heavenly consequences. But you'll still face the consequences here on earth. It shows us that God's commands aren't for God, they're for us. God doesn't need you to follow his law. You could break every one of his laws, his commandments. It doesn't affect God. It affects you. Right? God doesn't need your righteousness. You need your righteousness. God gave us his commands for our benefit, not his benefit. Let's look at the Bible. Job 22, verse 2. Can a person do anything to help God? Can even a wise person be helpful to him? Is it any advantage to the Almighty if you are righteous? Would it be any gain to him if you are perfect? If you were perfect. God's commands are there to help us. Follow God's commands because that's the best way you can live the life that God had destined for you. God's commands are there to help you, to bless you, to give you the abundant life. So when you hear me say these things, don't hear me say you don't need to listen to the Ten Commandments. I say to you, listen to them more. Do them more. Put them more into your life. Don't do them less. But when you mess up, which you will, you have Jesus that takes the penalty and the punishment for that. Whether you're a sinner or whether you're a saint, God loves you. Your sin, though it will affect you, doesn't affect God's love for you. That's a bit freaky, isn't it? If we do something wrong, There's almost something inherent in all of us. I got to get back in God's good books. I got to do this thing. I'm going to make sure I do my devotions this way. I'll give a bit extra in the offering. I'm going to do something. I'm going to volunteer in this area. I'm going to do something to kind of get back into God's good books. But whether you do something fantastic, God doesn't love you more. Or whether you do something terrible, God doesn't love you more. Whether you're a sinner or whether you're a saint, God still loves you. Jesus, through his death and resurrection, dealt with all sin. Think about this scripture that you've all memorized. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So if God loves the world, and Jesus came not to condemn the world, how we treat the people that we do life with has to be affected. If I've been forgiven, then I have to have that capacity in myself to forgive someone else. We have to love the ones we love, but we also have to love the ones that we don't love. Whether someone is a sinner or someone is a saint, we need to love them. We need to love and we need to forgive the people that we don't really want to. Romans 12:17. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Don't take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, "Is mine to avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, think about this, whether you're a sinner, whether you're a saint, God still loves you. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you'll be heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Yeah. You know, sometimes it's easier to listen and agree with the Bible than to do the Bible. Yeah. Right? Because that's a challenge. Yeah. But the Bible is best used by being a doer of the word, not just a hearer of the word. See, when we don't take the situation in our hands, when we pray for those who spitefully use us and hurt us, we actually leave room for God to act. People who have done wrong to you expect revenge. They expect some sort of comeback. But when you act in love, there's actually no greater example of God, and they don't know how to handle it. They're expecting payback. They're expecting retribution. They're expecting anger. They're expecting some response. But all of a sudden, they're confronted with love. They're just like, what? Yeah. See, when an evil act is perpetrated on you, it's actually easy to allow your reaction to be revenge. I'll show them. I'll get even. But you don't overcome evil with more evil. You overcome evil with good. If you repay evil for evil, it's just a race to the bottom. Right? And it's never, ever going to win. And that'll never, ever bring glory to God. Let me show you how. Luke 6, verse 27. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, and pray for those who spitefully use you. I love the way that he uses that, spitefully. So someone's actually gone out of their way to hurt you. It wasn't even an accident. It wasn't just something they overlooked. It wasn't just something where they kind of did it by accident. No, they meant it. They wanted to hurt you. They wanted your bad. Pray for those who spitefully use you. But love your enemies, do good, and lend, hoping. Why does it have to have that word? Hoping for nothing in return. So I give it to you. Hope you don't. I hope I don't get this back. Yeah, I don't like you. I don't want to give this. I still remember the hardest thing I ever gave away was something that I was given for free. Right? I was given a dozen Tour brand Bridgestone golf balls that the pros use. Right? And I'm driving someone to the airport that I didn't like, and the Holy Spirit tells me, give him your golf balls. There's the last person in the world who deserved good golf balls. Right? And I did it to the very last minute. Like, I'm just fighting with myself. Like, he's almost just walking away. He goes back, oh, by the way, here, I just thought I'd give you these. Through gritted teeth. Right? I'll never forget that. But love your enemies, do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return, and your reward will be great. And listen to this, because this is the key. For you will be you will be sons of the Most High. For He is kind to the unthankful and the evil. It's got to be really careful how we treat some of the people in the world who really are enemies of the faith. Because God is kind to them. So let us be kind to them. So the only real way to forgive someone is to pray for someone. That's the only way. That's literally the litmus test. If you can pray for them, because that's what Jesus said to do. He goes, actually pray for someone who spitefully used you. So when we come to a time of prayer, the Holy Spirit will always bring to mind someone we have an attitude with. Someone that disturbs your spirit, whose actions have disturbed you. And I've always wondered about that, because I'll go into prayer and it's almost like, oh, that guy, she did this. And then it's like, but I'm here to pray. But I want to say, because God does that on purpose. He brings that person, He brings that circumstance, He brings that which has disturbed your spirit, so that you're actually making Jesus Lord in that particular area, and then heaven is opened up to you. You have an access then to heaven that you didn't actually have before. So let's have a look. Is this scriptural? Yes, it is. Mark 11:25. And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive them. See, forgiveness comes at the beginning of prayer. Our forgiveness of others opens heaven up to us. So if someone spitefully uses you, you pray for them. Right? And what happens is that you do it in the beginning because the Bible says so. Because there's an upset in your spirit as you go to pray. You do it because you have to. There is no emotion attached to it. There's no feeling attached to it. God, I pray for this person, touch them, I pray you bless them, but you don't really feel it. You're actually still a bit annoyed with them, and you're almost annoyed that you have to pray for them, right? And that's where it starts. It starts there. They're here, and you're here. God, I pray for them. God, that they should know, and God, why don't you just show them what they did wrong to me? No, that's not what God's asking you to pray, right? God, I pray that you know, that brick falls on their head. No, that God's not asking you to pray for that. Right? It's a really good communion message today, Laura, because it's fitted right into our message, right? Right? I pray for that. How can I go so slow? Right? So I remember once, this is a true story, right? This lady's going really slow in front of me, and I had to get Jack to kindergarten, and I'm going right up close, trying to show her. She should be going faster. And then she got there, and it just did a little bit on the left for me to get past her. So I went past her, and then I looked out, and it was a lady from church. And I go, oh, hello, Lucy. How are you, Lucy? Good to see Pastor Mark here, the holy Pastor Mark. Bless you, Lucy. Good to see you, right? That's literally true, right? Terrible. But my point. Okay, so they're here. You're praying for them, God. But then you start saying, God, you know, touch their family. Touch them, Lord. And what happens is as you do it, all of a sudden you find yourself like having a feeling. And then all of a sudden you start to pray for them. God, I touch their family, Lord. Touch their family. Bless them. Let them have a great day at work, Lord. Whatever it be. And so you find yourself starting in obedience, but slowly working up to where, what is it? You're showing grace. Undeserved favor. Like the favor that God shows us. It's not deserved. It's undeserved. This person doesn't deserve your favor. This person doesn't deserve your prayers. This person doesn't deserve your actions. But you're doing that. So what did the Bible say there? You become like a son of the Most High. You become like God. You actually start to show grace. And that's what happens. And so all of a sudden, the hurt and the pain and all the feelings that you feel, all of a sudden go there, and you can actually love a person who's actually spitefully used you. But it's a daily thing we need to do at times, right? Because the next day you wake up, you go to prayer again, and then all of a sudden, notice one thing. This person has never changed. It's not actually about them. It's about you. Where are you? Are you going to stay here under their curse, under what's ever happened to you? Or are you going to come and pray and then bless them and become like a son of the Most High, become like God and show someone grace, undeserved favor? And all of a sudden, the poison and the kind of tie that they have to you is broken. Because now you're not under them, you're over them, so to speak, and you've allowed God to do what he wants to do. And what I want to say, thank you. It's extremely practical. And I promise you, right, that is something that actually works. It's something. And what happens is the next day, because, you know, the Bible talks about, our Father in heaven and, you know, give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. So what happens is that, like, it's something we have to do on a daily basis. Because the next day you wake up again. But what you find is that as you continually do this with maybe a person, a particular person, you get to there quicker. What took you a little while to get to, all of a sudden you get to there. And then one day you'll just find that it's just not an issue anymore. And you can actually look in the eyes of that person. You can be with that person. Now, I'm not saying you forget. I'm not saying that you put yourself back in a place where you could be abused or used or misused or however it is. That's not what I'm saying, because that's not what it's saying either. It's in prayer that you do this thing. So you don't put yourself back in that position, but all of a sudden the power of the circumstance is now in your hands rather than being in their hands. And what I've noticed is this. So there was one person that I, and if I were to tell you the things that they did, you would all agree with me that they were a rotter, right? You would all agree with me that I had a good reason to be mad with them, right? But the Lord would say, forgive, and I'll do this, and I'll do this. And then, you know, I've done it. And then what would happen a year later, when I've forgiven, I haven't even really thought about this person, I'll be in prayer, and this person will come to me again in a sense of disturbing my spirit. And I'll do it again. And one of the things that God showed me is that he would use this person to show me that when I was starting to become a little prideful, he would remind me of that. And he would always deal with my pride by, when I'm going into prayer, he'd remind me of the wrong things that this person had done to me. All of a sudden, emotion would be attached to it again, and so therefore I'd need to forgive again. But really what it was is that he's actually trying to deal with an area of pride that's over here. See, the thing is, you can't come into God's presence with pride when you've actually had to bow down and say, God, I just forgive this person who's actually hurt me. It's a state and a place of humility. So what we're going to do today is we're going to do that right now. And I want you to think of someone that has forgiven you, and I want you to start to pray. Sorry, I want you to start, think of someone that you need to forgive. Think of someone who's hurt you, right? And I should have some music here, but I haven't got any music, but that's all right. We can do it without. All right. So I want you, everyone, to close their eyes. I want you to take a moment, and I want you to think of someone who's been a rotter to you, someone who's hurt you, someone that doesn't really deserve your grace, someone who doesn't deserve your kindness. And I want you to just start to pray for them. Start to pray blessing upon them. Start to pray that God will be with them. Don't pray that God will show them something. Don't pray that God will show them why they're wrong and you're right. Pray blessing. Pray kindness. Pray God's love. Pray God's provision. Pray God's miracles. Pray God's presence. Pray for them right now. Father, we forgive those who have hurt us, who have used us, who have overlooked us, who have disregarded us, who should have acted better but didn't. Father, we forgive those who have abused us, oh God. Father, right now we forgive them and pray for them, oh God. We bless them, oh God. We ask that you would be with them, oh God, that you would anoint them and let them know your presence, oh God. Father, let miracles happen in their life. Let the goodness of God be at work in their lives. Father, we just ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. So, what if it's you who's the rotter? What if it's you who's done the wrong thing? All of us here have done some pretty shameful things. If I were to pass this microphone round and if I were to be able to somehow show on the screen the shameful things that you've done, there wouldn't be anyone left in here. We would all run in the quickest leaving of the car park ever in the history of an event, right? Because we've all done some pretty bad things. And sometimes we can't forget those things. And some of those things we can't take back. Nina has a great analogy. You know, once you squeeze toothpaste out the toothpaste tube, you can't put it back in again. And some of us have got some toothpaste out of the tube that we can't put back in again. How do you go? How do you forgive yourself? How do you receive and accept the forgiveness of God where you sometimes have to deal with the daily consequences of the things that you actually did? Because that's a deal with it. Whether you're a sinner or whether you're a saint, God still loves you. So we're going to have a look at another song by the same lady.
Thank you.
We've all got flaws. And it's a difficult thing. See, whether it's yourself, whether you're a sinner or whether you're a saint, God still loves you. I think it's the most God-like thing of God. That regardless of our flaws, regardless of our mistakes, regardless of our issues and sins, He still loves us. But what about our sins? What about the issues that we have? And I just want to show you something. I always get nervous when I write on a whiteboard because I can't spell. As that lady, K-A-N-T-S-P-E-L. So I want to do a little bit of maths. I want to do a bit of Christian maths. So you got a sin, there's a failure. There's problems. You got problems, there's been an injustice. There's sin. There's turmoil. Oh. Sorry. Just. See, without Jesus, minus Jesus, failure. Minus Jesus. Minus Jesus. Minus Jesus. Justice minus Jesus. Sin minus Jesus. Turmoil minus Jesus. Equals something. Equals. Failure minus Jesus, all that does is equal resignation. You just resigned to the fact that you're not good enough, not able enough. Problems without Jesus minus Jesus equals fear. Injustice without Jesus makes you a prisoner of whatever it is that happened to you. Sin without Jesus equals makes you broken. And turmoil without Jesus just brings anxiety. Right? So what happens is that without Jesus, if you minus Jesus, if you haven't got Jesus with any of these flaws, failure, problems, injustice, sin, turmoil, if you haven't got Jesus, something negative happens. Well, what happens? What happens is that it's not about what you're minus, it's what when you're plus. So when you bring the cross. So when you bring the cross into your situation, when you plus Jesus into your situation, failure plus Jesus, hey, I've got hope again. Right? Problems. Right? When I add Jesus, all of a sudden I got faith. Injustice, when I had Jesus, all of a sudden now I've got freedom. Sin, without Jesus, I'm broken. With Jesus, when I add Jesus, I'm now whole. And the last one, turmoil, when I add Jesus, I haven't got anxiety, I've now got peace. Seeing these things, we've all got flaws. We've all got issues. But you've got to add Jesus. And when you add Jesus, it doesn't matter what flaw you have. Whether it be sin, you've got forgiveness. Whether you've got turmoil, there's peace. Whether there's betrayal, there's love. When there's failure, there's hope. Problems, faith. Injustice, freedom. See, God's always adding into our lives the The enemy is always wanting to steal from our lives. The thieves come to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come that you may have life, and life more abundant. And life means you're going to have flaws. Life means you're going to have sins. Life means you're going to have issues. Life means you're going to have injustices and betrayals. Life means that it's tough. There's a scripture in Ecclesiastes, and for much of history it's true. It says that the day of a man's death is better than the day of his birth. Because life is hard for so many people. And without Jesus, there is no hope. Without Jesus, there is no way. Without Jesus, there is no going on. But when you add Jesus, there's hope, faith, freedom, wholeness, peace, love. All the different things that Jesus promises us. So I want you to right now think of an area. Maybe the musicians can come. Think of an area where you're flawed. Maybe where anger has taken over at different times and you've failed. Maybe it's in a workplace, family. Maybe you've allowed the turmoil and things to steal away and just leave anxiety. Right now, close your eyes. Think of Jesus. I bring Jesus into that circumstance. Whether you're a sinner or whether you're a saint, He loves you. It's not about whether you've been good enough. It's not about whether you've done enough. It's about, can you add Jesus? Can you receive Him today? Can you receive Him today? We deal with God through Jesus. God deals with us through the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, right now, let your love, let your presence, let your kindness and your goodness, Father, draw men. Draw men. Draw women to you right now. Draw them. Whether someone's not a Christian in this place, or whether someone's been a Christian here for 100 years, draw them into the presence of Jesus. Draw them. Let them see that they're loved, oh God, whether they're a sinner or whether they're a saint. In Jesus' name. Amen.